Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, and the Mysterious Press present The Empire of Night by Robert Olen Butler. Read by Ray Chase. Chapter 1. I know a stage door Johnny when I see one, and I know a tough guy. This was no Johnny. I had my reasons not to look at the facade of the Duke of York's, and perhaps that's how I came to notice him down the alleyway on the south side of the theater. The midsummer's late sunlight was almost gone, and the play-going crowd was hubbubbing at the front doors, and here was this lurker in the shadows around the corner, on the way to where only the company of actors was supposed to go. He'd crammed a bouncer's body into a three-piece serge, and his trilby hat was pulled down and tipped forward. I gave off pretty much the same impression, I realized, but I wouldn't want to see somebody like me down this alley either. He was turned sideways and looking in my direction, probably thinking similar thoughts. There was nothing to do about it. Sniffing around on the sly for my government while still trying to more or less sniff the same way for my newspaper had made me excessively suspicious of my fellow man. I would have been a busy guy indeed if I'd tried to deal with every mug who put me on edge. The Trilby and I stared at each other for a long moment, and then he broke the gaze and slid away down the alley, fading into the shadows. I shrugged him off and figured it was time to go to my seat, which meant I had to face the wired sign thrusting out over the Duke of York's portico. In my coat pocket was a ticket for the front row of the stalls, so I had to deal with this. I turned. The theater event of the decade, for a limited run only, was ringed in electric lights. Isabel Cobb is Hamlet. My 56-year-old mother. When this ticket showed up on a bellhop tray at my hotel without a note, it took me by surprise. As close as I'd been to the theater all my life, I'd been unaware that the theatrical event of the decade was about to happen in London, much less that it involved my mother. I hadn't heard from or about her for 15 months. A couple of years ago, she retired from the legitimate theater, refusing to carry on in a profession that no longer let her pretend she was a 20-year-old beauty. She was still pretty much a beauty, but she wasn't Juliet anymore, or even Kate in Shrew, which an audience in Memphis finally, infamously made clear enough to her, summer before last. There would be no older woman roles for her, by God. She would rather leave it all behind. But here was a clever way around that problem. She was playing the most famous man in the history of the stage, a young man even. Under the portico now, I found myself on the edge of a gaggle of shirt-waisted women talking low among themselves, a few with a bit of purple, green, and white ribbon pinned near the heart. Suffragettes, their focus shifted by the war. Instead of marching and chaining themselves to railings, they were starting to drive trams and buses and work in factories. Some of these women near me even gave off a whiff of sulfur from a munitions plant, their hands and faces beginning to turn faintly yellow from the chemicals. As we pressed together through the doors and into the foyer, my mother's name floated ardently out of these voices. Their new exemplar. She was to be a man. To be and not to be, of course. But tonight, a man. I sat on the right end of the first row, very near to her as she came downstage, alone and soliloquizing, wishing that her too sallied flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself into a dew. I was trying hard to relinquish myself to the illusion of the stage, trying to forget who, in life, this was before me. To my surprise, this was not difficult. Isabel Cobb was indeed a man. She was a small and slim Prince Hamlet, her hair cut shoulder length and dyed dark blonde and worn loose and wavy, as a young man of the time might, being hatless in distracted grief. And though my mind knew how tightly my mother was wrapped inside her black doublet, and though I recognized her voice, which was always low and a little husky even as a woman, and though I recognized those vast dark eyes as the maternal origin of my own, She convinced me. And I wondered, did she convince herself? Perhaps. I heard no tang of irony in her voice as she, being a man, a son, railed against a mother's hasty sexuality. And though this Hamlet before me was believably his own man, he and his qualms reminded me of my mother. Not that I shared the prince's vehemence. But as he rolled the word frailty in his mouth like an overripe grape and then named it woman, stirring the suffragettes in the crowd to a titter, I stopped seeing the play. I lifted my eyes from Hamlet's indictment of his mother and looked up, far up into the fly galleries, uniquely visible to the residents of the front row, and to the catwalk there, its pin rail wrapped with thick hemp ropes. The catwalk was empty and my mind lifted much farther than the flies. I stood outside a room in the Gilsey House in New York, though it could have been a room in any of 100 hotels or boarding houses around the corner from 100 theaters and 100 cities on the headliner circuit where one of the great stars of the American stage and her son lived while she worked. The star was my mother, and she was my father too, my Gertrude and King Hamlet both, though my actual father was no king, was not even a ghost, was an unknown to me to this very day. But what son needed a father with a mother who could convincingly become anyone? This flash of memory, me standing in the hushed and carpeted hallway of New York's Gilsey House, could have been any from a multitude of memories of my childhood or adolescence in any of those other hotels. But in the front row of the Duke of York's, it was the Gilsey, and I'd just turned 13 and my cheek was still damp from her kiss, and she expected me, as always, to understand that she was about to shut the door in my face and send me away. It had been thus for as long as I could remember. I was much younger than this when I'd first been cooingly sent away from her door. And at the Gilsey House, her leading man had pitched in, had given me a wink and a nod and a good lad, and her play, what was it, a Clyde Fitch, perhaps? Had run a tryout month in Boston where I'd been bid a similar affectionate ado in the hallway outside a room in the Hotel Turan with a different leading man. And I liked this Boston guy okay, and I thought he and I would have this understanding for as long as the play ran, which everyone hoped would be at least a year in New York. Well, the producer canned him before the play left Beantown, and this guy at the Gilsey was a new wink and a new nod. My mother always seemed to have a hasty hankering for her leading men, and I always seemed to be seeing them off together at a hotel door and then turning and walking away, having quickly learned not to linger, not to listen. All this ran quickly and hotly and stupidly in me from the front row of the Duke of York's, so it took me a moment to realize what I was looking at. The guy from the alley was on the catwalk. Once I focused on him, I could picture the last few moments. He'd eased out slow to a place at the rail, and now he squared around to look down to the stage where Hamlet was finishing his soliloquy, bidding his heart to break. And this guy had a real intense interest in this Hamlet, who was my mother. I had a real intense interest in him. I concentrated on his face as he watched Hamlet greet Ophelia with feigned madness. I wanted to read his eyes, but they were a little too far away, and I wasn't looking straight into them. But the stillness of him, the casual privilege of his pose, made them seem hard, as insolently hard as his stare from the alleyway. Shakespeare and Isabel Cobb faded into a buzz in my head as I focused on this man and on my instinct that he was up to no good. And then he turned his attention to me, casually, as if he'd known I was there all along. We had a second extended face-off. I was right about his eyes. They seemed dead, these eyes, as dead as a bullet casing. He returned his gaze to my mother. I was tempted to slip from my seat right that moment with Hamlet tormenting the girl he loved and go through the stage access door into the wings and find my way up to the flies. And then do what? Cool off now, I told myself. For weeks I'd been sitting in a London hotel room preparing for the next assignment. Necessarily so. but I'd been idle for too long. This guy reminded me what my body had been trained for and primed for, which, however, certainly hadn't been to cause a public ruckus over some lug because I didn't like his looks or his sneaking around. I lowered my face. I concentrated on Hamlet advising his girl to be off to a nunnery and then making a flourish of an exit. A few moments later, with Ophelia still boo-hooing about her boyfriend's madness, I looked up once more into the flies. He was gone. I let it go. At the first intermission, after Hamlet vowed to catch the conscience of the king, I went out of the theater and down to the side alley and smoked a cigarette there, watching the shadows, waiting for a tough guy in a trilby. Nothing doing. Back in the theater, through to the next curtain, I kept a frequent but fleeting eye on the flies. No sign of him, and now Hamlet was swearing that his thoughts be bloody or be nothing worth. At the beginning of the act, I'd have embraced that recommendation. As the curtain came down for the second intermission, I'd finally been able to drift in the other direction. So I went out and smoked another Fatima and kept my back to the suffragette chatter nearby on the sidewalk and thought about how my mother was indeed Hamlet, as it said, rimmed in electric light above my head. And she was a good one, neatly balancing the classic introspective inaction with the strength to kill. Inside the theater once more, she held my undivided attention through to the prince's last words, "The rest is silence," and in the script there is but a single word of stage direction, "dies." For most actors who have taken on Hamlet, the rest is not silence. The rattling or sighing or moaning or gasping are considered by the usual tribe of actors to be the sweet dessert to a long night of emoting. I feared for my mother now, in spite of the surprising subtlety of her performance so far, feared for her excesses. And she surprised me once more by dying with simply an exquisite lifting of the face to the spotlight and a closing of the eyes, and thereby an ineffably rendered release of spirit. I admired her performance, but I did not like to witness this, in much the same way as I did not like her closing a hotel room door upon me. I felt she had left me forever, and with her death upon my mind, for it was hers as well as Hamlet's that I was thrumming to, I lifted my own face once more to the flies. And there he was. He was watching once again at the railing, and as my mother played at death, he leaned toward her and his jacket gaped briefly and showed a holstered pistol on his left side. I wished ardently that I was carrying my own. From the early days of my reporting career, I got close to a fair number of criminals. Tough guys, all of them. Tempered steel, tough. But I'd heard a number of them talk about their mothers, think about their mothers, and inevitably these tough guys turned into simpering idiots of a variety of sorts, from weak to reckless. So it was that even as I wished I had my own pistol with me, I was grateful I didn't. I felt trigger-itchy at that moment, and it was possible my hand would have drawn my Mauser and would have pushed the safety button and would have waited for the slightest movement of this lug's right hand toward his pistol, with the wrong kind of look on his face, and I would have shot him. Maybe not aiming to kill, maybe just to disable that right arm. Without this option, however, I clearly understood that shooting him would have been the wrong thing to do. At least till his pistol was out and coming to bear on her. And then I would have simply killed him. Chapter 2. As it was, he didn't do anything but watch for the last few moments of the play. Then the curtain fell, and when it rose and the calls began, he was gone for good. The audience clapped loudly, and the rest of the cast came and bowed and lined up on the sides, and they joined the applause as my mother appeared. She bounded downstage center, and the women in shirtwaists and suffragette ribbons all stood up and cried, "Bravo, bravo!" And my mother bowed deeply to them as a man, and then she straightened and flounced her hair, and she curtsied as a woman. The suffragettes cried, "Brava, brava!" All the while, the rest of the viewers were applauding loudly, some of them rising to their feet as well. As did I. My mother did not look my way. A boy brought roses from the wings. I'd seen bigger ovations for my mother, but the few actresses who'd done Hamlet before had been pilloried in the press and heckled from the cheap seats. I hadn't read her reviews, but I heard not a single rude sound from this audience, and that seemed a triumph to me. I lingered to let the crowd murmur its way out of the auditorium after Mother had finally stopped taking bows and the house lights had come on. Then I crossed before the front row. But instead of going left up the aisle to the exit doors, I went to the right, up the steps and through the stage access door and into the wings with its smells of grease paint and sweat and dust burning on the electric stage lights. The actors had all vanished, and squaring around before me was a lanky man in shirt sleeves and bow tie. The stage manager, I assumed. I was ready to explain myself to him, why I felt privileged to go through an unauthorized door and head straight to the dressing rooms, but he immediately said, "Mr. Cobb." "Yes," I said. "Would you like to see your mother?" "I would." "This way." He turned on his heel to lead me toward a door at the back wall. I stepped up quickly to walk beside him. "There was a man with a gun up on your fly floor," I said. "Are you surprised?" He stopped. He turned to me. "A gun," he said. "Inside his coat?" "Yes," he said. "I'm surprised." "Do you know who he might have been?" I asked. The stage manager hesitated at this. He was thinking in ways that I could not clearly interpret. Then he said, "Not if he was in my flies." "And if he hadn't gotten that far?" "Your mother has fans." This was no fan. He turned and moved on. "Please follow me," he said. Something was odd here, but I didn't push the point. As we passed through the doorway at the back of the stage wings, I said, "How did you know me?" "Your mother has a picture of you in her dressing room." This didn't surprise me. I followed him along a short passageway, and we cut back at the next turning and entered an enclosed staircase. Her dressing room was on the second floor. The door was ajar and emitting female laughter. The stage manager knocked and the laughter faded. "Prithee, show thyself," my mother called out, using the lowest Hamlet register of her voice. More female laughter. The stage manager leaned his head past the edge of the door to look in. "Your son," he said. I did not hear her reply if she made one. Perhaps she gestured. The stage manager pulled back at once and opened the door, and I stepped in. She sat with her back to her makeup mirror, still in her costume of trunk hose and doublet, the doublet unbuttoned, however, showing a finely embroidered lace blouse beneath, straight from a Mayfair shop, no doubt, her own private joke throughout the night's portrayal of Hamlet, a secret assertion of her modern womanhood. She was flanked by four suffragettes, two on each side, their uniform dark skirts and white shirtwaists making them look like a ladies' string quartet about to go off to play in a palm court at a local hotel. I stopped a single pace into the room, my hat in my hand. My mother rose, quite formally, even solemnly. Then she took a step forward and opened her arms. "My darling Kit," she said. I came to her and we hugged, and she smelled of grease paint and mothball camphor, and she felt all bones and sinew inside her man's clothes. "Isn't he handsome, my dears?" she said. The women simply made little muttering sounds in response, ready for the vote, but not for boldly voicing the sort of sentiments my mother was challenging them to have. I focused on her suffragettes as my mother resisted my incipient withdrawal from her arms, assessing them as she would have them assess me. They were varying degrees of young. Mother had brought only the more impressionable acolytes into her closest circle, but three of them did not hold my eye even for a moment. One, though, had a strong-jawed, wide-mouthed sort of farm girl prettiness, the kind of girl you'd enjoy trying briefly to pry away from her horse. Mother was letting go of me now, pushing me back to arm's length, but keeping her hands on my shoulders. "Where have you been for the past year?" Where she had been was a more interesting question, but I politely did not ask it in front of the young women for whom she was still performing. Ah, yes, she said, as if just remembering. I read your stories lately. What a fine writer you are. I taught him to write by making him read 1,000 books and count the star dressing rooms on 3 continents. The hem was the only indication she'd suddenly started to talk directly to the other women, as her eyes kept fixed tightly on mine, shining that light of hers on me, making me a willing part of her present performance. She said, elaborating on her perusal of my stories, "But Constantinople, of all places," she said. "All those poor people suffering under the Ottomans. A terrible business. Why would you ever go out there? I thought you were the great chronicler of bullets and cannon shells and men in battle dress, my darling." I did not have a chance to reply. "And your ordeal on the high seas," she said, the light changing in her eyes, giving off more heat and less illumination. "Did you get my telegram?"
"No."
"Well, I didn't know where to send it."
"Then you already knew I didn't get it. But I didn't say this."
"He was on the Lusitania," she said.
The suffragettes clucked softly in sympathy. "Closer to 3,000, I said. Her eyes narrowed.
"Utter non sequitur, my darling," she said.
"The number of books you had me read. I figured it out not long ago." She brightened. "In an idle moment," I said. And then to the others, "She and an ever-changing cast of theater people she enlisted taught me everything I knew before I knew to teach myself." As she had done, I did not look directly at the suffragettes, letting the pronoun suggest I was addressing them. Mother let go of my shoulders. She introduced me to the young women, and I smiled at them and shook their hands, their grip still limply disenfranchised, but I did not endeavor to remember any of the names. Even though it went against my natural inclinations, the name of the pretty one. Immediately after the introductions, my mother ushered them all out of the dressing room, everyone fluttering ardent goodbyes and comradely good wishes every step of the way. Mother closed the door and leaned back against it.
"Was I splendid tonight?" she asked.
The question was not rhetorical, though I knew she knew the answer. "You were?" I said.
"Yes, I was," she said.
"Does all of London realize it?" I asked.
"Much of London."
Some of the critics surely sneered at any woman playing the role, but she seemed content, so I did not ask.
"Poor Bernard," she said.
Sarah Bernhardt played Hamlet in London in 1999 to vicious reviews. Mother was inviting the comparison. "You did better?" I asked.
"Yes," she said, "but I was referring to her leg. They cut it off only a few weeks ago, and she gave it to a university."
From Isabel Cobb's Hamlet in London to Sarah Bernhardt's losing a leg, service to my government had put me behind in my reading.
"Gangrene,"
my mother said. "So you're doing better than the divine Sarah in legs as well," I said. Mother lifted her face to the ceiling in a loud bark of a laugh. But when her face came back down, she grabbed a chaw of my cheek between her thumb and forefinger and gave it a squeeze and shake to match the laugh.
"I feel bad for her," she said.
"I have a pretty high threshold of pain, but like those Chicago thugs going soft about their mothers, I felt the same at 31 years old about Isabel Cobb's uninhibited mother cheek pinch as I did at 10. It hurt like hell." She finally let go, and she sat down in the chair where she'd been presiding over her suffragettes. I sat in the chair at the idle makeup station next to her. Edged into the frame of her mirror was my formal portrait in a cabinet card, a thing she'd insisted I do for her 6 years ago upon hearing that the Post Express was sending me off to Nicaragua on my first war assignment. She caught me looking at it.
"I carry you with me everywhere," she said.
I turned to her. In spite of her being made up as a man, a melancholy man no less, and being an age that tormented her always for what she no longer was, my mother was still beautiful, her face in impact, all dark eyes and wide mouth, both restlessly shaping and reshaping in attentiveness to whoever was before her. It had long pleased me to be able to make her eyes and mouth abruptly freeze, like now. "Can you think why a tough guy with a gun would be stalking you?" I said. But I had her for only the briefest of moments. Then, with a tilt of the head, her eyes veiled themselves like a cat showing its trust, and her mouth made a dismissive moo. "Not at all," she said. She sounded sincere, but she was arguably the greatest living actress of the American stage. She could sound however she liked. What I needed to figure out, had the oddness of the question itself been enough to make her pause for that brief moment? Or had it revealed she was now lying? I had good reason to suspect the latter. Last year she got involved in some undercover detective work in New Orleans while she was trying to make an escape from the theater. "Are you still in bed with Pinkerton?" I said.
"What do you take me for?" she said. "Old man Pinkerton's been dead for 30 years.
She winked. "Okay, Mother," I said. "I usually let you get away with ending a serious conversational topic with an ambiguous theatrical gesture. Not this time. Does the wink mean you're not sleeping with a dead man, but if he were alive, it would be a different matter? Or does it mean you're not sleeping with a dead man, but you may still be working for his detective agency?" This stopped her face once again. She squared around to me, leaned forward, straightened her back, and pressed her hands onto her knees. A manly gesture. A man with more backbone than Hamlet. But I recognized it from a lifetime with this woman as a no-nonsense Isabel Cobb gesture. She said,
"Listen to me, my darling. Consider my ego. Did you think I would be happy to play that role for long? Going after two-bit hoodlums for a corporation of private dicks?"
I kept my own face still. I wasn't going to let her get away with the ambiguity of a rhetorical question. She knew. She smiled a "that's my boy" smile.
"It was beneath me," she said. "I am not now, nor will I ever again work for the Pinkertons or any other detective agency."
She held my eyes steadily with hers. "Okay. Okay," I said. She didn't move. "That leaves the man with a pistol in his coat," I said. "He was in the flies above you." She didn't flinch. Her face was placid, but she said,
"That's unsettling."
How to read my mother. That had been a daily challenge for much of my life. It probably made me the hell of a good newspaper reporter that I was. Right now, I believed what she was saying about the detective work. Her reasoning acknowledged who she was behind the mask. This quiet in her also felt real, I supposed. But she was perfectly capable of playing from her actor's book of tricks, placid and calm. Playing the untrue thing was her life. If the calm were true, wouldn't she be squeezing every flinch and flutter from a fictitious endangerment? She said,
"Maybe the theater put on some security. A woman playing a man provokes a lot of people on both sides."
"Your stage manager said he didn't know who he was." She nodded faintly. Then she shrugged.
"We do only a matinee tomorrow, and the run ends Thursday night."
There wasn't much left to say about this. It worried me. But this was my mother I was dealing with. I let her change the subject. "Do you tour on from here?" I asked.
"Yes."
A few moments of silence clock ticked away as we looked at each other, as if casually. "As Hamlet?"
"Yes," she said. "And you? Will you be waiting in London for the German bullets and cannon shells to arrive?"
Another beat of silence, and then she smiled, and she winked. She was reminding me that we'd long ago tacitly agreed not to question how we led our lives. "I'll be touring on," I said. Chapter 3. I asked nothing more of her, nor she of me. By the very early hours of the next morning, however, as I lay sleepless in bed in my rooms at the Tavistock Hotel across from Covent Garden Market, I'd become less and less convinced by her performance. Not her Hamlet, that remained swell. In temperament, she'd always been something of a man, a tough guy, in fact, trapped in a leading lady body. Indeed, last night she'd played the catching of the murderous uncle at his prayers so fiercely and had so clearly kept that edge in all her character's later delays that she'd utterly transformed Hamlet's Wilsonian vacillation into the overriding desire to kill his uncle only when it was most likely to send him unrepentant to hell. That was Mama. She knew how to draw on her toughness, play it as if that were all there was. Which was why it took me till 3 a.m. to begin to doubt her nonchalance about the man in the flies with the gun. Something more was going on. But it wasn't my affair. I was still a war correspondent. There was that. But I was also working for my country's secret service now. Primarily now. She wasn't the reason I was awake. I'd always figured she could take care of herself. And I was my tough guy mother's son. Which wasn't to say certain things in my new profession didn't get to me. It meant I played the essentials of my character convincingly, and I did what I needed to do. I just might not sleep for long stretches in the night. I fidgeted mightily around on the bed. I paced about the room smoking Fatimas, a room I'd occupied for going on 10 weeks now. My own issues were about the 13 months prior to that. But I was tough guy enough to keep any extended replays of those scenes out of my head. From the battlefields I'd covered, I'd learned the attitude I had to hold on to. The man you watched die yesterday doesn't exist today. He fell to yesterday's bullets, and you've got today's bullets to deal with. Nevertheless, sometimes it got me to brooding. Only it was in indirect ways. Like noticing a little girl, maybe 9 years old or so, from a working family, passing in James Street with a sad face. Or a newspaper headline about a film actress, a star, formerly thought rescued but now assumed lost on the Lusitania. Or the arcaded portico along the front of the Tavistock, which felt, in spite of obvious differences, very much like the portales of a certain hotel in Veracruz. And making all this worse was the Corona portable on my desk, which I'd paced past 100 times already tonight and kept my eyes from seeing. This time, however, I stopped. The electric bulb above the desk, wired into the gas jet fixtures of this 60-year-old hotel, pissed its yellow light onto a blank sheet of paper in the roller. One more story to write under a phony name. No, I couldn't think of it as phony. That was the point. I was Joseph W. Hunter speaking through my corona now. Joseph William Hunter, formerly Joseph Wilhelm Jaeger, which I was keeping quiet about. From Chicago, he was publishing widely in the German-language newspapers and the German-American English-language newspapers in the USA. He was a damn good writer, sentence to sentence at least, though he clearly had an agenda. He was a justifier and apologist for the home country. No, not he. I was this guy, Hunter. Becoming him, at least. I was still in love with mein Vaterland and anxious that my fellow Americans understood why. I was writing about the war as if America was smart to remain out of the fray, as if we were getting the wrong dope about Germany and its goals and its intentions. We had far more in common with the Germans than we did with the Brits. It turned my stomach, but it had to be done. It was quite likely, given recent events, that Christopher Cobb was known to the German Foreign Office as a dangerous man. Journalism was what I knew best as a cover identity, and Germany was still courting sympathetic American journalists. Joe Hunter would be useful. He was in the works even before my mix-up with the Huns this past spring. I'd been creating him ever since I came out of my Secret Service training in February speaking damn good German, the language training aided by a lifetime of intense and varied private education in the backstages and dressing rooms of the 1,000 theaters of my childhood and by my mother's gene for mimicry. I'd lit the electric light with a reasonable intent of making good use of my sleeplessness. I had a story to cook up about a movement among Chicago school administrators who advocated more classes in German in anticipation of a new order in Europe. But I reconsidered. I was Cobb alone tonight. Only Cobb. I reached up and turned the key and extinguished the light. I moved to the window and opened the heavy blackout drape. It was the newest thing in the room. Since January, London faced the nightly possibility of a Zeppelin attack. Since May, the attacks had come to city center and were increasing in number and bomb load. The Brits still hadn't figured out how to defend themselves. The airships could climb faster and higher than the Sopwiths and Blériots of the Royal Flying Corps, and the best the anti-aircraft ground defenses had were Hotchkiss six-pounders whose range was less than half the Zepp's attack altitude. The city was defenseless. My rooms were at the back of the hotel on the upper floor, the fourth. I looked along the parapets and chimneys of the rooftops stretching north on James Street, all of it barely visible, blacked out, as was the whole city in the overcast night. And as I watched, the darkness to the west cracked open from ground to clouds with a white searchlight, and then with another, the two beams stiffly scanning the ceiling of clouds. I took in a quick breath. These zeppelins were as vast as ocean liners, piston droning a mile overhead, slowing down almost to a float to aim their bombs, giving off a strange kind of elegance in their dangerousness. They were unlike anything you knew, no matter how much tough stuff you'd seen. They could set off a quick reflex of fear you didn't quite know how to suppress. I watched the two restless pillars of light searching, searching, and then one abruptly vanished, and moments later the other. The darkness resumed unmitigated. It had been a false alarm. In this part of the city, the dark was not silent. Though I was high up and facing away to the north, I could hear the muffled bustling at the Covent Garden Market across from the front of the hotel. The market carts and wagons were rumbling in and unloading cabbages and cauliflowers, turnips and tomatoes, broad beans and Brussels sprouts to await the greengrocers of London before dawn. I closed the drape. I'd been here too long. I knew too much about this neighborhood. I was too much like a Londoner, waiting for bombs from the night sky with nothing to do in response but keep the lights off and duck. I went to the armoire and opened the doors, and I felt my way into the bottom of my Gladstone bag. I put my hand to the Luger there, which I'd acquired on a difficult night in Istanbul. I drew it out. I faced into the darkness of the room and held the pistol as if to fire, holding the grip with the crotch of my thumb pressed into the curve beneath the hammer, the trigger snug in the tip joint of my forefinger, my hand part of the Luger now. An exact prolongation of its axis. Calming. And unsettling. I'd been calmed through the other wars by typewriter keys. What had I come to? But this reservation was of the mind. My body, my beating heart were calmed by holding this pistol. I let the thought go. I put the Luger back into the bag and I moved to the bed and lay down and slept. And a knock at the door awoke me. I did not know what time it was. I didn't even know if the sun had risen, the blackout lingering in the bedraped room. I rose. I moved to the door. There was no peephole in this aging hotel. I turned my ear to the place where a peephole should be. Yes, I said.
Mr. Cobb.
I recognized the voice. A bellhop as old as the Tavistock. I slid the chain lock off its metal groove and opened the door.
Good morning, Mr. Cobb.
Good morning, George, I said. George lifted a long paper-wrapped parcel with the hook of a clothes hanger protruding from the top.
From a gentleman, he said.
With the door closed and with a blackout drape opened to reveal the light of an advanced morning and with a parcel laid flat on the bed, I tore away the paper and found a tuxedo. The note pinned to the paper gave an address in Knightsbridge and the present date and a time. No name. I took in a quick breath, aware how similar the reflex seemed to the anticipation of the Zepps a few hours ago, but with a different feeling altogether. The last time that I'd been sent off on a serious assignment, it began with a tuxedo. My waiting, I figured, was over. Chapter 4. That night, after the late coming summer dark, gussied up and still fiddling with my white bow tie in the back of one of the ubiquitous French-made London taxis, I thought about a guy named James Metcalf, my contact from the embassy in May, who dispatched me a tux and took me to dinner at the Carlton Hotel to give me a train ticket to Turkey and a license to kill. I expected him to be waiting for me in Knightsbridge. The taxi drove to the end of Basil Street, just south of Hyde Park, where Basil Mansion stretched a full block long, a continuous row of posh, red brick, Queen Anne Revival mansion flats with half-octagonal, Portland stone bay windows. The mansion's flat-ironed at the angled intersection of Pavilion Road, and the northernmost door I'd been brought to led into a massive wedge of a very fancy multi-storied flat, four floors from basement on up, joined by a circular staircase. A manservant in tails answered the door, and he bowed to me and he said, with lugubrious upper-class over-precision, "Good evening, sir. May I announce you?" Which was just his way of saying, "Who the hell are you?" I gave him my name, the Cobb one. "Of course, Mr. Cobb," he said. He had the acceptable list in his head. "This way, sir," he said, and he led me across the marble foyer and up one circular flight to the second floor, the central feature of which was a large oak-paneled drawing room. The furniture was all done in the heavy, dark Jacobean style. Oak wainscot chairs mostly hugged the walls, overstuffed out-of-period wingbacks, and a matching couch sat before a walk-in fireplace, and a couple of major fat-legged trestle tables lined up in the center of the room, one with a side of beef and a guy in chef's whites, the other with drinks and a bartender. But among all this was plenty of stand-around room. There were a dozen of us, or a few more. All men, all done up in evening wear, arranged in little broods of two or three just out of earshot of each other. I smelled government. The butler stopped, and so did I, just behind his right shoulder. "Lord Buffington will be here momentarily, sir," he said. Indeed, from near the beef, a large, fleshy man who seemed no less large and fleshy for his perfectly bespoke evening clothes, a man who once might well have been the primary bully among Charterhouse upperclassmen, broke away from his group and moved toward me. "Mr. Christopher Cobb, your lordship," the manservant said, stepping out of the way.
"Cobb," the man said, presenting a large hand and a firm grip that I was lucky to get good enough hold on to return effectively. "I'm Gabriel Buffington."
"Lord Buffington?"
He'd given me his casual name, but he nodded to acknowledge that I'd done the right thing in returning his title to him. And now a man emerged from behind Gabe Buffington, a man I recognized. But it wasn't James Metcalf. It was my other James, the guy who came to Chicago and persuaded my publisher to let him hire me away for the government while remaining ostensibly at work for the Post Express. James Polk Trask, Woodrow Wilson's right-hand Secret Service man. Trask appeared around Buffington like a halfback running the ball behind Gabe the grappler's block. I sidestepped to take him on. "Trask," I said.
"Cobb," he said. We shook hands.
"Lord Buffington is our host," Trask said at once, turning his face around to look at the Brit. Buffington nodded two little smiles, one for each of us.
"Thanks," I said.
Buffington said, "The windows are secured. The food and the drink are plentiful. We have a splendid space below ground. Let the wretched Huns do their worst."
Having made this declaration, the Lord nodded once more firmly for both of us, and he moved off. Trask watched Buffington.
"He's one of the good ones." He turned those blackout dark, empty-seeming eyes back to me. He waited, as if it was obvious that I was supposed to say something. Since he'd come to recruit me, I'd seen those eyes in other people in his business. Our business. I figured he expected me to acquire the knack of putting on these show-nothing eyes, just as I'd acquired the knack for planting an enemy in the ground. A couple of moments of silence had already passed between us since he'd declared Buffington a good one. I said, as in one of the few good ones, or stay close to the good ones because the bad ones are very bad? Trask smiled very faintly. Both, he said. You want a drink? Sure. I've taught the Brits to make a gin ricky, at least here in Buffington's joint. It was the only drink invented by a Washington lobbyist. That may be a violation of our neutrality, I said. Too bad, Trask said, and he led me to the drink table and another of Buffington's servants in tails. This one, however, was armed with a cocktail shaker, ice shaver, lemon squeezer, long-handled spoons and toddy sticks, a jigger, and a couple of fine small knives. He used one of the latter to cut us a lime, the halves of which ended up in our two glasses of beefeater. Trask took us off to a corner of the room and we sat on a couple of high-backed carved walnut chairs facing at right angles into the room. We were able to watch for anyone approaching. No doubt Trask's intent. We would speak low. What's this get-together all about? I asked. Trask gave a tiny snort through a whistly sinus. I looked toward him at this commonplace noise he'd made. It didn't go with his eyes. It didn't go with him, this peep of human frailty. He said, "This is a high-class version of a thing you're starting to find all over London. A blackout club." "The Zeps," I said. He nodded. "All you need is a basement and some nervous friends." "Are these guys nervous?" "From the air attacks, a few. But mostly from their long neglect of homeland defense and the task of correcting that. They'd all gotten complacent about their island fortress. Their vaunted navy can't do anything about airships. Churchill warned them before he got canned. He foresaw a major air war. I suspect he'll turn out to be correct. Unfortunately, Winnie didn't know crumpets about sea war and land war." Trask was referring to Gallipoli. Churchill had authored the disaster in the Dardanelles, which wasn't over yet. "I got pretty close to all that," I said. "Right," Trask said. "Which reminds me, good work in Istanbul." I grunted. "Yesterday's bullets." "That compliment wasn't as incidental as it sounded," Trask said, as if he were a sensitive guy not wanting to offend. His eyes hadn't moved from me, hadn't flickered through any of this. Not even when he added, "Not incidental at all." I practiced on my own dead stare. Trask said, "Sorry to reward you by hitching you to a post in London for so long." I didn't even grunt at this. Trask knew how to justify it. He said, "Your Mr. Hunter has been getting some nice response in various places." "Good for him. Now we're trying to do our British friends, the good ones, a special favor." This declaration was the kind of rhetorical setup Trask liked to execute before taking a sip or a drag of whatever was in his hand. A Ricky in Washington when he sent me off on the Lusitania, a Fatima when he asked to enlist me in his covert tribe, and yes, a Ricky again now. I sipped too, waiting. "They've got a traitor inside somewhere," he said. "Inside the government?" "They think so, given what they suspect is getting through to Berlin." "Will I be involved in this?" Trask shrugged. He looked off into the room. "We have someone on it at the moment, looking into a suspect." He said no more. I took a pretty good hit on the gin and lime. Old Joe Ricky and his Washington bartender friend had a real inspiration, simple though it was. "We're still feeling our way along," Trask finally added. "It might be a good time to introduce Mr. Hunter."
"Here?"
"I have a slightly different crowd in mind."
He leaned toward me, lowered his voice even further.
"Do you know how many of the most powerful men in this country have German blood in their veins?
It goes back 200 years. George the First, King of Great Britain and Ireland, previously Georg Ludwig, Duke of Brunswick-Lüneburg, the only eligible heir of the dead Queen Anne. He didn't even speak English. This was Queen Victoria's great-great-grandfather, mind you, progenitor of 3 British kings before her. And who did Victoria up and marry? Another Hun, Albert of Saxe-Coburg and Gotha, who thus named the present royal house. For Christ's sake, the Kaiser himself is Victoria's grandson. There's been a powerful lot of German-blooded begetting over those 200 years, which has now produced, beneath the Brits' virulently anti-German surface, a small but strategic shitpot of conflicting interests at a very high level. "Your suspect is one of the begotten?" I said. Trask nodded. He glanced into the room and back to me. He bent near. A baronet by the discreetly adjusted surname of Stockman. Given named after Victoria's German prince, Sir Albert Stockman. He's the great-nephew of Christian Friedrich Stockmar, a German-born physician who became the personal doctor for Prince Leopold of, where else? Saxe-Coburg and Gotha. Great-uncle Chris was sent by Leopold to a marriageable Victoria to vouch for his own nephew, Albert. Stockmar vouched well, and after the marriage he stayed on as the young couple's personal advisor. So Victoria took good care of this guy's extended family, including the baronetcy of our Sir Al. "Why don't the Brits just grab him and interrogate him?" "It's all suspicion at this point," he said. And the operative phrase was very high level. Sir Albert was beloved by blood by the great queen herself, which counts in this country. And though a baronetcy doesn't quite rank the House of Lords, he got himself elected as a member of Parliament, which, if he's dirty, tells you something about his guile. From outside, very near, a whistle sounded shriller, simpler than the Bobby's whistles. An air raid constable. This the Brits were well prepared for. Guys in uniforms with whistles. The conversations instantly stopped in the drawing room. All the faces turned in the direction of the sound, the southern wall and the street beyond. I looked at Trask. He looked at me. "Here come their cousins in a balloon," I said. Trask snorted. I snorted. But we both rose and moved with all the other white ties and dinner jackets into the circular staircase, going along in a quite orderly fashion, quite calmly, even as the sound of the Hotchkiss six-pounders began to pop pathetically in the distance. We descended to the ground floor, and then we circled on down into the basement, and we emerged into a large open space. At one end sat wine in barrels and more wine in bottles in racks, and on half a dozen of the barrels, candles burned in silver candelabra. Against the far wall were more racks of a different sort, layered with Buffington's guns. In the center of the open space, a billiard table was disappearing even now under a white cloth cast over its surface by still another liveried man. Beyond the vanishing billiard green were 3 round dining tables already draped in white and each set with half a dozen dinner places and lit as well by candles. Beyond them was an opening to a corridor in deep shadow, leading into the recesses of the basement floor. On one side of the doorway was a piano with a lit stand-up lamp. On the other side was a wall of books, 2 shilling editions, books for a man to actually read. For that purpose he had a couple of overstuffed Morris chairs with another stand-up lamp between them, this one dark. The basement, at least on this side of that corridor, was Buffington's guy's retreat. We all now vaguely drifted in the direction of the set tables until Buffington's voice boomed from behind us. "Gentlemen, the food and the drink will soon follow, and there will be more of both. But first, a word." We stopped drifting. We began to turn toward our host. He was drawn up to full height, hands behind him, framed against the final swoop of the staircase. He watched us turning to him. He approved. He waited. He encouraged us as we gathered our attention to him by addressing us once more. "Gentlemen." Firmly he said it, though the tone of his voice had mellowed up as well, become comradely, almost affectionate.
When at last he had the full and silent attention of every man before him, he said one more time, "Gentlemen." This time he rolled the word out as if he were asking us to consider its full meaning. Which no doubt he was, for he went on, "They come now, showing their true and savage selves. They come in the night, sneaking and dangling beneath gas bags to throw bombs on our homes and schools, on our women and our children. And a few months ago, they unleashed poison gas upon our troops at Ypres, violating what civilized men from time immemorial have understood to be fields of honor. This is no longer a war of nation against nation. It is a war of civilization against a new barbarism. We fight to preserve the entire world from a second dark age." As if off stage, the sound effects man heard his cue. A bomb thumped distantly and shuddered faintly beneath our feet. Buffington paused only for a single beat as if to let his point sink in. Before me and to the side, I could see most of the men in the room, and I knew I could assume the same of the others. Not one of us had flinched. And here in this London home, the bomb's fading vibration in our feet and legs and chest supported Buffington's point. He said, "Gentlemen, if we fail, this dark age will be longer than the last. Those previous 5 centuries will seem the winking of an eye compared to this, and the new dark age will be infinitely more terrible. Mankind's vaunted advances of manufacturing and technology can be used for good, but they can just as readily and effectively be used for evil." One more drub of a bomb, much closer, rattled our knees and stirred the silverware on the tables. Buffington boomed in response, "Consider that the call to roast beef and Yorkshire pudding." We all certainly were happy to take that attitude, but no one moved, not even Buffington. We waited for the next one, this moment and the next. The Germans were still working on aerial warfare. So far, the raids were widely spaced and had come with one or two airships following a single ongoing path across the city and flying away. This bomb was very near, and from the direction of the earlier distant blasts, the next would either be farther away along the flight path, or it would be right on top of us. We waited. "Shall we sit?" Buffington's voice had diminished a little. This was a question now, not a defiant suggestion. And there was a stroke of sound, more distant, barely felt in Buffington's cellar. "Bloody hell," someone said nearby, very low to himself. We heard no more until we were sitting with 4 others at the far table. Trask and I were beside each other, and I could look, if I wished, between 2 steel-gray, slick-maned Brits across from me and down the darkened corridor leading to the rest of the basement floor. We heard 1 more bomb before the food, like a distant stroke of thunder, someone else's storm. And then we ate. Our companions introduced themselves but did not declare their work, nor did they ask ours, which made me suspect they were Foreign Office types, Secret Service, no doubt, at least some of them. Their talk was casual, but it was bluntly critical about Britain's progress so far in the war, about the disastrous 4-week gap between the sea attack and the land attack in Gallipoli, about the severe shortage of artillery shells, about the hasty training of 1 million new troops, about the U-boat threat and the Zeppelin threat, and the sudden vulnerability of sacred British soil after centuries of comfortable insularity. Trask and I said little. When the 4 began to lean toward each other and debate the need to dissolve the government and form a new one, I leaned too toward Trask and said, low, "Are all these guys in your line of work?" Trask nodded. "In varying degrees." The 4 men stopped talking abruptly. I thought at first that they'd overheard us, trained as they perhaps were. But their faces had turned not to us, but to a point higher up and beyond Trask's far shoulder. I looked, and Buffington had arrived, and he put his hand on the shoulder of a stout man with a crooked cravat sitting next to Trask. The man needed no word. He nodded and rose and moved off, and Buffington sat down. He said to the other three, "Sorry, gentlemen, continue." And they did, with one of them saying Kitchener, who was the Secretary of State for War and who all three agreed was responsible for the shortage of artillery shells, had to resign no matter what they did with Asquith. Buffington drew Trask toward him. I leaned along as well, and neither of them made the slightest gesture to suggest I was not invited. Buffington said, "Stockman's throwing a weekend house party." "Your man?" Trask said. Buffington said, "In the vicinity." Trask nodded, and then he made the tiniest intentional movement of his head, so tiny that I instantly doubted my perception, figured I was an example of how you can overtrain a Secret Service agent. The movement, I thought, was this very slight turn in my direction, since I'd drawn near behind Trask's right shoulder, as if it was a subtle gesture to Buffington, reminding him of my presence. "Is she ready?" he said. What did all that have to do with me? I sat back in my chair. My eyes moved across the table and between the two steel-gray heads who had sat back as well, now that they'd agreed to throw out Asquith and Kitchener and all the rest of them. I looked into the darkness of the corridor, and the darkness moved. That was the first impression, lasting only a brief moment. The darkness shifted, swelled, and then points of light began to clarify into a face, hands, and a piano started playing the instrumental introduction to a song, and I recognized it, the intro to Keep the Home Fires Burning. And the face emerging from the shadows of the corridor heading this way became clear, and now I recognized it as well, even as I had a sense of movement to my left, Buffington no doubt standing up to address us all. He said, "Gentlemen, in the interests of preserving civilization as we wait out this latest barbarous attack, I give you the great Isabel Cobb." My mother emerged fully into the room, dressed in black, and she stopped framed in the doorway as the men at our table wrenched around, turned their chairs, applauded, and cried out, "Hear, hear!" The introduction was over, and Mother shot the piano player a brief glance as he fumbled a bit with the transition to the verse. I glanced with her, and it was the stout man Buffington had replaced at the table. This was a select and secretive group. Isabel Cobb's accompanist was drawn from one of our own number. He wasn't terrible at this, however, and he found his way into the verse, and Mother looked back to us and began to sing. I heard her voice, but for a few moments, as far as I knew, she could have been singing a soliloquy from Hamlet as I grappled with my surprise at her presence here. And then she was inserting that phony ache into her voice that she was so good at. Phony mostly to my ear, of course. Fans loved it. But indeed, she drew even me in with it now as she sang, "Let no tears add to their hardships as the soldiers pass along. And although your heart is breaking, make it sing this cheery song." The Secret Service pianist did all right with the transition of the chorus, and Mama floated on in, more achy than ever. "Keep the home fires burning while your hearts are yearning," she sang, and she began to work the room, gliding along the table, singing to each stiff upper lip individually. "Though your lads are far away, they dream of home." And bringing a tear to each eye and a stirring to each stirrable part, "There's a silver lining through the dark clouds shining." And she gave me a little less eye contact than the others and a pat on the shoulder as she slid by. "Turn the dark cloud inside out till the boys come home." I watched her as she moved on to Trask. He lifted his face to her, and a son knows certain things for reasons he can't put his finger on easily, or the reasons seem minute and insubstantial. But Trask's eyes and my mother's held on each other for one pulse beat, one intake of breath, and I knew there was something between them. This particular son knowing certain things about this particular mother made me think in my usual weary little way, lovers. Then he nodded once very faintly with those blank eyes of his, and I felt my intuition shift. She was not sleeping with him. She was working for him.
"Is she ready?" he'd said. "Ready for Sir Albert Stockman's weekend party." She moved along, singing, "Overseas there came a pleading, help a nation in distress." And Buffington extended his hand, and she took it, and she sang to him, and I had the same first fleeting hunch about him. She was working for Trask, but she was sleeping with Buffington. And then I felt like the punk kid I once was, standing outside a closed door in a theatrical boarding house, trying to will his mother to live her life in some other way. What way, I couldn't imagine, just some other way. But in fact, I was 31 years old and she was 56, and we had long ago disentangled ourselves from our shared life. And rightly so. We wrote letters, an occasional telegram. But all of that was strictly private. As public, I had subsequently become, and she had always been, it was not really known, outside of a few of my journalist pals and the close-knit tribe of American theater people, that we were mother and son. She let go of her host's hand, and I let go of the hunch, and she moved off to the next table to urge everyone to keep their home fires burning while their hearts were yearning. I thought of her lying to me in her dressing room. No, she hadn't lied. It was no doubt true that she was not now working, nor would she ever work again for a detective agency. But she didn't say anything at all about working for the U.S. Secret Service. She convinced me about the Pinkertons by invoking her ego. Her ego would be thoroughly satisfied playing the role of spy for her country. Just the thing for a great actress who is furious with the theater for not overlooking her advancing age. As a spy, she could still be a glamorous leading lady. And her performance had a special edge. Her life could depend on it being convincing. I turned around in my chair, shut out her voice, poked at a roasted potato. My mother segued from the home fires into an upbeat, pack up your troubles in your old kit bag, and then she finished with an even more achy, there's a long, long trail. The music stopped, the gentleman cheered, she left, and a rhubarb crumble arrived. In the midst of all this, Buffington rose and followed her up the circular stairway, and Trask turned to me as the ramekins landed before us. "Your mother is working for us," he said. "I surmised," I said. And though I felt the irony, given my recent bout of musty hunches, I asked the obvious question. "Is she going after Sir Albert?" "Yes," Trask said. And then he added, "So are you." Chapter 5. The next night, Isabel Cobb ended her run in London as Hamlet, Prince of Denmark. She'd swept out of her basement cabaret on the night of the most recent Zeppelin attack on London, and it wasn't until Friday morning that I saw her again, when she stepped into a first-class compartment at Victoria Station for the train to Broadstairs in Kent, and she sat down across from the American journalist and German apologist, Joseph W. Hunter. Trask had booked the compartment so that she and I would be alone, but she entered playing a stranger, nodding at me and then ignoring me as she settled in, arranging her handbag next to her just so, its corners squared to the edge of the upholstered bench seat. I watched this with a vaguely squirmy sense of recognition. I always did that very thing with the pages of a story as they came out of my typewriter. She finished with her bag and then smoothed her overskirt. Though it hardly needed smoothing, it was a stage gesture. She looked quite summery in a blueberry bolero jacket and straw boater with a matching ribbon and pleated bow. She turned her face to me now, even as I was thinking how she looked pretty good, and she tightened her forehead as if I were a young man on the mash. I refused to play along. "We have the compartment to ourselves, Mother," I said in a tone of, "We both know this, so what are all the theatrics for?" She flared her hands in front of her. "Can't we have a little fun, my darling? Improvisation. How long has it been since we rode a train together? We used to have so much fun." I shrugged and looked out of the window beside me. A conductor strode past, blowing his all-aboard whistle.
You were always a clever boy, she said. A talented boy.
We rode enough trains together between theater towns to circle the earth and circle it again. For as long as I could think back, we would play roles together to pass the time. Over the years, I was everyone from a beggar boy running away from an orphanage to a dry goods commercial traveler who was Isabel Cobb's biggest fan and overwhelmed to meet her. She once had hopes I'd follow her into the theater. The train was moving now, and I turned back to Mother. She was watching out the window. Her face was blank. I knew the look. I'd seen it often in stage wings just before she would make her first entrance. This blankness was all she would show of the actor's inevitable terror of reinventing herself before 1,000 strangers watching from the dark. This time her audience would be smaller and she would walk among them, and things were at stake far beyond entertaining a theater crowd. I knew to let her be. The outward blankness would last until her entrance cue, and then she would come suddenly alive as if she'd flipped an electric light switch. I glanced at her only briefly and stealthily, but her preparatory state went on, through our run across the Thames and through Clapham and Herne Hill, with her old estates turning into middle-class commuter houses, and through our plunge into the dark of the long tunnel beneath the Crystal Palace. Here, the electric lights in the compartment flickered us into total darkness. We clattered through the blackness for a long moment, and when the lights flared back on again, I looked frankly at her and she had closed her eyes. I believed her fear. I wanted to reach out and take her hand, but I knew better. What would she take as her entrance cue on this day? The lights blinked off once more and then almost instantly back on, and her eyes were open, as if they had been all along and what I'd seen was wrong. But she was still preparing. Only when we were above ground and finished with London and into the county of Kent and we were rushing through vast hops gardens, the plants beginning to bloom into gold, ready for the seasonal pickers to come down from the slums of London, only then did she turn her face back to me.
The curtain goes up, she said.
I nodded.
What the hell are you doing? I said. What do you mean?
This role of yours.
And you, my son. I was quite surprised to learn about your own specialized acting career.
You already knew about me the other night.
Of course.
She leaned forward and patted me on the knee.
Aren't we having fun?
There was nothing to say to that.
Of course she was.
I decided to watch the hops for a while. Trask had briefed me before we parted at Buffington's. I'd been invited to stay the weekend at Stockman House, his family estate high on the chalk cliffs between Broadstairs and Ramsgate. I was following Isabel Cobb, doing a feature story on her for the de facto syndicate of German-leaning American newspapers that were making my reputation. The News Hook was the next stop on her tour of Hamlet. Berlin. A detail she deliberately withheld from our discussion of her tour in her dressing room. I was to stay alert to, even at my discretion, seek out evidence that Sir Albert was indeed actively aiding the German cause. My mother was doing the same. This will be an interesting test of your new identity, Trask had said. I wasn't worried. There had been almost no images of me in the press over these half dozen years of my war correspondent notoriety. I'd insisted on that. My printed words were my public face. There was, however, another issue. I'd said to Trask, she and I have kept it quiet for more than a decade, but the Germans surely know she's my mother. He'd simply nodded. We were drinking brandy in the two Morris chairs after everyone else had cleared out of Buffington's basement bunker. This is very risky for her, I said. Trask did a lift of the left shoulder and a tilt of the head in the same direction, both equally minute. A characteristic shrug I'd seen more than once.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.